All right, so we're continuing our discussion about the conservation of momentum. Remember, we're talking about conservation of linear momentum. And if you remember from the previous video, what we're basically doing is applying Newton's second law of motion. It states that the time rate of change of momentum on a system is equal to the sum of the forces on that system. And the system of interest for us, again, is a differentially small control volume. So our first kind of task was to come up with a way to express the forces that are acting on this control volume. And typically we don't talk about forces, we talk about force per unit area, and that's what we call stress. But the complication comes in because these forces have a certain direction associated with them. So a force is a vector quantity, but also the orientation of the surface is important. So we need to be able to keep track of the orientation of the surface on which the force is acting, and we do that using what's called a normal vector. So it's a unit vector that's perpendicular to the surface of interest. So we need to simultaneously keep track of the force, which is a vector quantity, and the normal vector, which is also a vector quantity, in order to describe these stresses. So for that reason, because we have two vector quantities that we need to keep track of at the same time, the stress is described by a tensor quantity that has 9 components. So we denote it here, tau yx, shown here. So the first index represents the orientation of the surface. So this is the stress due to a force acting on a surface with a normal in the y direction due to a force that is in the x direction. Okay, so the first index indicates the surface orientation that we're talking about, and the second index indicates the force. So we applied this to this differential control volume. We're showing a 2D projection here. And just like we did for conservation of mass, we mapped the stresses to their corresponding values at each face of this square. And we noticed also that we had to define a sign convention to determine or to allow us to classify whether a stress is positive or negative. And our convention is that if the force being exerted is due to a fluid at a greater value of the first index of this tensor, y, x for example, let's look at the x face, on a surface with a lesser value of that index, then that's defined as positive. So for example, this fluid that's acting on the surface is at a greater value of x than the position of the surface. So this is defined as a positive stress. And here the fluid at a lesser value of x is acting on the surface at a greater value of x. So this is negative. And you can see similar for the shear stresses on these y surfaces. So the next question becomes then, how can we put this together and get an expression for the sum of the forces? So again, we're looking at forces in the x direction in this example here. So the first term we have can involve a body force due to gravity that acts on the control volume, because that's the kind of force that may be important in the kinds of flows that we look at. So this is the gravitational term. This is the force due to gravitational acceleration. So it's a body force, meaning that it acts over the volume rather than over the surface. And this gx term here is the x component of the gravity vector g, because remember that the acceleration due to gravity is a vector quantity. Now we can talk about the stresses that are due to the forces acting in the x direction. And so we can start with the surfaces whose normal vector is in the x direction, the left and right hand faces of this control volume. So we have on the left hand side tau xx plus the partial of tau xx with respect to x times minus delta x over 2. And remember, by our sign convention, that's a negative stress by the sign convention that I just showed here. So I have a minus sign here. And then on the other face, on the right-hand face, we have tau xx plus partial of tau xx with respect to x times delta x over 2. And I have a plus sign, a positive sign associated with that, because, again, due to our sign convention, the fluid that's acting on the surface is at a greater value of x than the surface. And that's multiplied by the area of this face, delta y, delta z. Then I can go forward and continue on the other faces. So on the face with a normal vector in the y direction, I have tau yx plus the partial of tau yx with respect to y times minus delta y over 2 for the bottom face. And by our sign convention, that's a negative stress, plus the partial of tau yx with respect to x times delta y over 2 plus tau yx. And that's multiplied by the area of that face, delta x, delta z. And then on the front and back side of the surface, I have the tau zx plus the partial of tau zx with respect to z times minus delta z over 2 for the back side. And that's a negative stress due to our, as a negative sign due based on our convention, plus tau zx plus the partial of tau zx with respect to z times delta z over 2. And that's multiplied by the area of that face, which is delta x, delta y. Okay, so notice that these, again, these plus and minus signs are defined based on the convention that we stated here. Another thing we can notice, again, is that the normal stress components cancel out. I have a minus tau xx here and a plus tau xx here. Same for tau yx and tau yx on the top and bottom, and tau zx and tau zx, that term on the front and back sides. So these terms cancel out, and so then I can combine what I have left. So I get rho times the x component of the gravitational acceleration vector plus the partial of tau xx with respect to x plus the partial of tau yx with respect to y plus the partial of tau zx with respect to z, all times the volume of this element, delta x, delta y, delta z, the volume of this cube. Okay, so I can go on and apply exactly the same analysis on the cube, considering forces acting in the y direction and forces acting in the z direction. I do exactly the same process, and so I get that the y component of the sum of the forces is rho g sub y plus the partial of tau xy with respect to x plus the partial of tau yy with respect to y plus the partial of tau zy with respect to z times the volume delta x delta y delta z. And in the z component, I get rho g sub z plus partial of tau xz with respect to z plus a partial of tau yz with respect to y plus a partial of tau zz with respect to z times the volume of the element delta x delta y delta z. Okay, so now let's step back a little bit and remember that we need to consider the momentum also that's carried into and out of the control volume by flow. So we got the sum of the forces, right? So in Newton's law of motion, the sum of the forces equals the time rate of change in momentum. So that's true. If this were solid mechanics, then we'd be done, and we could go on and apply this equation for our momentum balance. But we had in a flowing system in fluid mechanics, it's possible that we have an additional contribution due to momentum carried into and out of the control volume by flow. So how do we describe this contribution? And remember, for when we talked about the conservation of mass, we expressed mass flow through a surface by this quantity, rho v dot n. So remember, v dot n is the projection of the velocity vector normal to the surface. So this represents the component of the flow that's actually going through the surface. And this entire term is an expression of a flux, because the units are kilograms per meter squared second. So it's kilogram per second, a mass flow rate per area. Okay, so now we would like to try to get an analogous expression for the inflow and outflow of momentum. And so we can do that as follows. We can start with this definition and express the momentum flow or the momentum flux in terms of this quantity, rho v times v dot n. So again, remember, the v dot n term allows us to select the component of the velocity that's actually passing through the surface. And so this is analogous to the mass flow. It's like a momentum flux. So remember, momentum is mass times velocity, mv. So that has units of kilograms, meters per second, mass times velocity, per second. So it's a momentum flow rate per area. So it's exactly the same, except instead of accounting for mass, like we did in the conservation of mass, we're accounting for momentum flow. And we can do that using this term, rho v times v dot n.